as psychologists, we're trained to be impartial and neutral and not give too much of ourselves up. And it's not about us, it's about the client, which is very true. However, I've always felt that that approach never really worked so well for actual healing and growth. And so over time, as I became more confident in what I did and having done it more and getting some gray hairs, I decided over time that I was going to start doing things how I felt it should be done instead of the way it's supposed to be done. And so I started to write a little bit more about my experiences because I found that in the room with my clients, the things that I was sharing with them as it related to their own experiences actually was helpful. And they said, thank you. And every time I would just offer, let me just tell you a little bit something, an experience that relates, they would say, actually, that's the most important thing that you could have told me today. And I tried all this other fancy stuff. You know, that didn't work so well. This story starts with a, and I'm going to keep walking all over the place, so I hope you're not dizzy, with a real person who looks a lot like this person, who, this is about 4 years ago, came into our Napa office, and she sat down, and she said, in a very warm and direct way, you don't know me, but I know you. I said, okay, and it just turns out that one of the wonderful things about working with amazing people is I get to work with other members of their family and their friends. And she says, you've worked with these people and these people and these people and these people and these people. And I know what you did with this person and this person and this person and this person. And so basically, I have a question for you. What's your secret? And of course, being the kind of person I am, my heart started racing. I started looking around thinking, she knows my secret. Like, what is my... Oh my gosh, what did I do? What's my, you know, I had a, and I literally, my heart was jumping and I said, well, what do you mean? And she said, apparently you get it. And I thought, oh, I kind of breathed a little bit there. Like, okay. I said, oh, I hope so. That's what I try to do. And then she just looked at me and said, why do you? Which I thought was a really interesting question. And I didn't have a really good answer. I mean, I said, well, I've been doing this for a while and I'm really interested and passionate about these types of kids. And, I have kids with similar characteristics. And then we moved on. But it's something that was sticking with me. And I was like, what, why? Why do I know this? And so, this is about 4 years ago. I'm going to get through kind of quickly about 44, turned 44 last month, 44 years. And a lot of things kind of converged about this time, which is another example of we are never done growing. We are always evolving, and places like this is going to help you do that. I remember school being pretty fun to go to for a long time. And it was like second and third grade, you had to start really doing stuff. Like you had to really start writing. And then you had math, and then reading came into the fore. And I always remember these battles with my mom about, read, why don't you read? Why don't you read? I'll read later. I don't want to read. Slow down with your writing. People can't read it. Which I have heard, those of people who work with me understand that one. There were meltdowns. I remember distinctly third grade, I had a project, a big long essay. I remember crying at the kitchen table. I can't do it, I can't do it. And my mom painstakingly saying, I'm gonna show you, we're gonna take one fact at a time and we're gonna stick it on an index card. And I remember having the whole box of index cards, which was cool because I like cards, but was not cool is now those 50 cards had to be made into paragraphs and sentences. Another funny story, when I was looking through stuff, I found one of my old like fourth or fifth grade reports, and it said, the feedback was, Danny, excellent job. However, reports need to have more words in them. And I looked through, I did all pictures. It was awesome. I love to draw. So here I am in third grade. I'm in the right below Mrs. Dodson in the far right, middle row. This is the first year that I consciously remember faking it and being really anxious about it. what happened was we had to do a book report, and we had to pick a book report, pick a book from the library, and then read it over the next month or two, and then you go up and you give an oral report. And it was now we're in chapter books, bigger books. So of course, I'm going to pick a book that looks cool and sounds cool. And so, of course, My Robot Buddy was a great book. In fact, this isn't, I looked for the original cover and book, this isn't it, because I remember what the cover looked like. And it got closer and closer, and I remember saying to myself, you know, I'll just read a little tomorrow. I'll just read a little tomorrow. And what I didn't realize at the time is this reading was so laborious, I just kept putting it off. And this book was, you know, like this thick, and when I look at it now, it does not seem that hard. But at the time, I kept putting it off. Well, sure enough, it's the day before, and the teacher announces, okay, tomorrow it's Danny and Sasha and Heidi's book reports. Uh-oh. What am I going to do? Well, I didn't know what I was going to do. I remember being really nervous all night. I remember wanting to tell my mom, but I didn't know what to tell her. So I got called up, and I walked up in front of the class, and this is really not characteristic of me, because I was a rule follower. I sat there, and I remember looking at all the students, and I told them what the book, My Robot Buddy, was about in my mind. And I remember, like, keep smiling, and the teacher smiling, and all of a sudden I realized, oh my gosh, what if someone else has read this book? After kids came up to me and said, that's a great book, I want to check it out. And I remember feeling the next week worried I was going to get caught. But I didn't. Then there was math. Oh boy, math. So fifth grade math, distinct memory, which is relevant, is that I thought I had this long division thing wired, and I remember Mr. K calling, you know, who wants to do a problem? And I actually raised my hand. I don't even think he called me out of the crowd. He was a really good teacher. I go up in front of the whole class, the blackboard, and it is a long division, simple long division, and I get up there. I have no clue where to start in this long division, which of course I'd spent hours on and had done long division before. It was just gone. It was just gone. I remember my heart beating. I remember feeling the eyes of everyone looking at me. And I remember sweet Mr. K saying, would you like me to help you get started? Which was code for, please do this for me. Okay. But again, these were just things looking back that really didn't make that much sense to me. Gate. I remember hearing about GATE. I remember taking the GATE test. And I also remember every single one of my friends got to go do these cool things after school. But I didn't. So I just guess I'm not as smart as they are, even though we're friends. But I'm just not that smart. They're the smart ones. Perfectionism can really be debilitating and limiting. And it's something we really need to focus on with our kids and educate them about what perfectionism or the perfectionist monster is. They can handle this intellectual information and do something with it. Experiencing success is key when you are twice exceptional. Because a lot of your life, unless you have some of the benefits of a homeschooling environment, is really hard, really frustrating, and you do not feel successful. And the other thing is, when you do find what you love to do, it feels good. It is self-reinforcing and motivating. So we have to find whatever that thing is for your child to offset some of the others. And what I learned, that this positive disintegration, which I didn't know what that thing was one of the most important experiences I never want to have again. But I grew tremendously from that experience. Our kids go through these. Many of you have gone through these. And these are important life lessons where we grow. Depression, anxiety, pain, sadness, it doesn't have to be for nothing. It can be for a growth-propelling experience. So life can feel very hard. Struggling is important. And most importantly, to accept oneself. It can be very, very hard when you have a special needs kids. And I also learned that raising a twice exceptional child is a special needs kid. It is a special needs kid. We have to find a way to accept our kids. One of the things that I had to go through was how to accept her for who she is, not who I wanted her to be, not who I thought that I was going to get. And once I could go through that process, things got a lot easier. Kids with special needs need a ton of intervention. They need early intervention as much as we can give it to them. and we need to teach them how the world works so they can make some better choices. They are smart people. We need to focus on the larger issue, which is coping, the real world, getting through stuff, not finish your homework. That's not the life lesson. It's the forest versus the trees. So we need to teach our children to persevere and not give up, focused on the big picture. Teach our children about their strengths and weaknesses. Educators often do not get and are not trained in dealing with twice exceptional kids when they don't have the basics, how to engage them in the higher level thinking and the creativity. That's where we all come in terms of educating and all you wonderful educators who are here. And a child can be young and old and tough and sensitive at the same time. Twice exceptional kids are very complex. They come in all shapes and sizes. The reason you are here as parents and as educators and allied people is because you want to help and figure them out. And it is tough to figure out. They need to be understood, and you guys need to be understood. That's one of the reasons you're here. You are going to be understood here. We have to lead with their strengths and their talents. What are they good at? What are they like? What do they like? That's what they're going to do in this world, and help support those weaknesses and those struggles, both because they need skills, but also to mitigate the damage and the toll it takes on their self-esteem and self-confidence. Help them develop accurate and realistic views of themselves. This perfectionistic thing where you have to do everything perfectly is not good. We all have strengths, we all have weaknesses, it is normal. We have to help them accept that and accept it within ourselves. We need to focus on the long haul, the big picture. It will be okay later, focus on it. Give it time. We have to teach our kids to persevere. We have to teach them how to face adversity. This is what creates successful people, not GPAs, AP scores, not what college you go to, not what degree you have. That does not create success or happiness. Dealing with life does. Include your kids in the problem solving. You're still the parent. Include them. They are wise. They do know themselves, even if they can't always articulate it. Growth, development, and maturity takes time. It's never fast enough, but it happens. The bottom line is, we have to laugh and have fun. You have to laugh and have fun. You need to enjoy these moments. These kids, as you all know, enrich our lives in a ways that you couldn't even imagine. Allow yourself to learn and be taught by them while you are guiding them along the way. You don't have to be smarter than them or know more than them. You're their coach, their guide, their mentor. You just gotta stay with them through thick and thin. And remember that life is a journey. And it's an adventure, and these kids take us to places that some of which we don't want to ever see, and also amazing places that you never thought that you would be.